Hi Pim, it's great to see you. We think we presented our rebel talent to you. What do you think about it as a corporate rebel?
Yeah, it looks good. Best introduction I've had so far.
Really? Perfect. So we are really excited for your presentation, Pim. So stage is yours.
Cool. Thanks a lot. So I'm very happy to be here. And I see today as a little bit of a celebration of the past couple of months. We've been working hard together with a team of enthusiastic people. We've been working quite hard to get the Turkish translation and the Turkish edition of our book out. And it was published yesterday. So today's a perfect time to share with you some of the insights of that book and to show you some of the research that we've done over the past couple of years to look at how companies can organize themselves radically different. So very different from what you are mostly used to, from what many people are used to. And today, during my talk, I'm going to go through a couple of these inspiring organizations and to show you on a quite practical level how they work differently than the vast majority of traditional command and control style organizations. But before I do that, a little bit of an introduction into Corporate Rebels. For those of you who are not familiar with the work that we do, I want to show you a bit of background. And also tell you how we actually got into this adventure of exploring highly progressive organizations. One important note, if you have any questions during the presentation, and I'm pretty sure you will do, or any comments to make, please add them to the Q&A section or in the chat. And I'm very happy to be able to answer those at the end of the session. So we have about 10-minute Q&A involved as well. So please drop all of your questions in there so we can respond to those at the end. So, starting with the story of Corporate Rebels, Joost and myself, almost 6 years ago, we quit our corporate jobs. Joost as a trained nanotechnologist, myself as an industrial engineer. We both started to work for companies and started our career quite some time ago to do the thing we had studied for and to do the thing that we were trained for. And we actually loved the job itself because it was a perfect fit with what we had studied for. It's what we wanted to do. But what frustrated us after working for 3 years in such large corporate organizations was the way that the work was structured and the way that the company was organized. We were completely frustrated by how a manager was telling us what to do, how there were so many rules and so much bureaucracy that it was impossible to make your own decisions and be creative or entrepreneurial in how you were doing your job. And there was no freedom whatsoever. It just had to come from the office to the office from 9 to 5, sit behind your desk, and then people were expected to be very productive. We were super frustrated and we couldn't picture ourselves working in environments like that for 40 more years. So we decided to quit. And that moment is now 6 years ago. And we decided to quit because we wanted to solve the problem that we experienced firsthand, which is the fact that too many people are unhappy or disengaged from their work. So many people spend their 40 hours a week working, sometimes even more, being frustrated or dragging themselves to the office because they simply are not happy with their work and their work environment. And we set out to solve this problem. So we started Corporate Rebels with the goal to make work more fun. And we did it, as I mentioned, to solve this main issue, the issue of not having any engaged people in the workplace. And we experienced this ourselves, as I mentioned, but there are way more people around the world who, unfortunately, are experiencing the exact same thing at work. And after diving a bit into some of the research, we clearly concluded that the way most companies currently work is terribly broken. And let's look at some of the research being done on the topic. And some might be familiar to you already, but still pretty damn painful to see these numbers. So if you look at the engagement in the workplace, so how passionate people are about their work and their work environment, there's just 15% of the world's population engaged at work. So just over one in 10 are actually passionate about their work and their work environment. As you can see, 67% of the people are disengaged. So they come into the office, do what they're being told, but are not truly passionate about their work or their work environment. And then 18% of the people, of the employees around the world in different sectors, different regions, are actively disengaged, meaning they dislike their work and their work environment to such an extent that they start sabotaging the workplace. And this is painful, right? There's almost 1 in 5 who's actively disengaged with their work. So you can see that this is quite painful for all of those people that experience it, but it's also painful for the organizations they work for. Because apparently these organizations have a huge amount of untapped potential. When so many people are sabotaging the workplace compared to the amount of just a small percentage of people being actively engaged. So, but that's not all, unfortunately. If you look at the amount of burnout symptoms in today's workplaces, research shows that 20% of the people always or often experience symptoms of a burnout. For example, dragging themselves to work, feeling ill because they are stressed and not very happy with their work and their work environments. 44% of the people sometimes experience these burnout symptoms, and just 33% of the people never have any burnout symptoms. So we're not just disengaging people, we're also literally making people sick by how we organize work today. And then another painful fact, 40% of the world's population, the working population, feels that their job makes no useful contribution to society. Meaning that they go to work every day, work from 9 to 5, do what they're being told, but they're not feeling that their job makes any useful contribution to society. So we're disengaging people, we're making them sick, and they're feeling useless or meaningless in the workplace. Which, if you show these numbers to me, is a very easy way to conclude that today's workplaces are broken. And with Corporate Rebels, our aim is to change this, to actually create organizations where people are highly motivated, where people thrive, and where people are truly passionate about the work and how they do their work. So 6 years ago, we started, but we started in a way that was maybe not so straightforward. Because as I told you, we were trained nanotechnologists and industrial engineer. And with those backgrounds, you can't really solve the problem of how to make work more fun. So we set out to travel around the world to visit the academics, entrepreneurs, CEOs, and companies that are highly progressive and that show that there is a better way of working that is actually much more fun and much more motivating to the people working in these organizations. So over the past 5.5 years, we've traveled around the world to learn from these organizations and from these academics and these CEOs, to interview them. So to get a better understanding of how work can be organized radically differently. We visited more than 150 of those over the past couple of years. And as I mentioned, wrote a book on what these companies do different. And in this today's presentation, I'm going to highlight some of the things that they do different, plus also show you some of these organizations and how they actually put that into practice. So what I'm going to walk you through first is the 8 trends. So what is kind of the conclusion of the research we've done? I'm going to show you the traditional way of organizing versus the progressive way of organizing. It's concluded into 8 trends, which are also the eight main themes of our book. It kind of gives you a rough idea of what these companies actually do different. So on the left-hand side of the screen, you see the focus of very traditional organizations. And on the right-hand side of the screen, you see the focus of these pioneering organizations that we've been visiting over the past 5.5 years. The first one is a move from profit to purpose and values. So where most traditional companies focus exclusively on making profit and continuously adding more profit to it, focusing on their quarterly returns and not really interested in anything beyond that. Of course, to please their shareholders and also to please the organizations themselves, at least financially. We see that these pioneering organizations focus much more on a purpose, something meaningful they want to contribute to the world. And having a very clear set of values in place, guiding their decision-making and guiding their approach to achieving this purpose. That being said, it's of course important for any company to make money. So profit is always important. But for these pioneering organizations, it's a fuel to get where they want to go and not the goal of actually making as much money as possible. The second trend is a move from hierarchical pyramids to a network of teams. And when we talk about this trend, we talk about the organizational structure. So where you have the traditional organizational pyramid in most organizations with the CEO on top, lots of management layers in between, mostly divided into functional departments like marketing, sales, operations, finance, HR. And then at the bottom of that so-called pyramid, you have the people that are doing most of the actual operational work. But there's so much bureaucracy in place, there's so much middle management in place that these people cannot really do their work in a good way. So that's why these pioneering organizations focus on creating a network of teams. And for those who have joined the previous talk by Bill Fisher, who talked briefly about Hire, that is a very good example of a company that split up the big 80,000 employee organization into more than 4,000 micro enterprises. So small companies that act as if they are separate companies, but collaborating in this network to deliver products and services to their customers. Therefore, pushing ownership very much to the front line of the organization and getting rid of these traditional departments that most of the time actually get in the way of doing good operational work. The third trend is a move from directive leadership to supportive leadership. So how can you get away from the idea that bosses, so the people at the top of the organization, are the ones who are making almost all decisions? And that frontline people always simply have to listen to what they say and are being directed in how they should be doing their work and what work they should be doing. Instead, these progressive organizations focus on what we call supportive leadership. So leaders who are there to support their teams as good as possible. And whether you like to call them coaches, coordinators, that doesn't really matter. In the end, it's all about making sure that leaders facilitate that their teams can excel in the work that they're doing. Not being there to control them and to command them, but instead being there to truly support them to deliver great work. Some companies are really advanced in this, and they push supportive leadership to such an extent that they allow their teams to select their own manager or to select a representative. So the teams are responsible for selecting their own leader. We visited one Swiss company called Haufe Umantis, who actually elects all of its leadership positions all the way up to the CEO every single year. So if a leader is underperforming and the rest of the organization doesn't feel comfortable with that person leading the organization, they can be voted out and will be replaced by somebody else in the organization. The fourth trend is from planning and predicting to experimenting and adapting. And as you've been listening to an Agile conference all day, I think this one is very familiar to you. So it's about getting away from the idea that you can plan and predict what's going to happen in the next couple of years. And instead focusing on continuously experimenting and adapting with new approaches to work, but also with new products and new services. To focus much more on the short term, trying a lot of things, replicating the experiments that work and expanding on those instead of continuously falling back on these long-term change programs and with neatly defined milestones for every single quarter. Because in reality, that simply doesn't work. The world has become way too complex to focus on planning and predicting. Some companies once again go pretty far in this. For example, a Swedish bank called Handelsbanken, one of the largest banks in Europe. They employ 14,000 people. And the interesting thing at Handelsbank is that even though it's a financial institution, a pretty large organization, still they have no annual budgeting cycle. So they believe that in order to be able to actually adapt to their changing business environment, they shouldn't have these fixed annual budgets in place that kind of keep the organization into this idea of planning and predicting. And instead they focus on continuously adapting to whatever it is they need. So rethinking the budgeting process is one really good example of this more experimental approach to work. The fifth trend, this is one of my personal favorites, is a move from rules and control to freedom and trust. So how can you give people the opportunity to use their own common sense, to use their own brains to make decisions instead of telling them what to do? Mostly through thick rule books that if one thing ever goes wrong in a company, a new rule is added that then is there for everybody in the whole organization to follow. This doesn't make any sense. We should facilitate an environment where people get to do the thing they love to do according to their own best judgment. we shouldn't be telling them how to do their job exactly, especially not if we need to leverage those things that people are good at, for example, creativity and innovation. So give them freedom and trust and get rid of all of those rules and those control mechanisms that try to control people and how they're making decisions. The sixth trend is from centralized authority to distributed authority. So how can you push decision-making as far to the front line as possible so that the people in close contact with customers and suppliers are actually the ones who can make their decisions? So they don't all the time have to go up the hierarchy to make decisions, to wait for approvals, and then go back to their customers again, because most of the time that's already too late for them. So give them the opportunity to make their own best decisions, because those people at the front line often know best what decision to make, not the managers who are hidden away in their offices. And the seventh trend is from secrecy to radical transparency. So how can you open up all kinds of information in the organization so people can actually make those good decisions? Think, for example, about opening up the company financials, showing everybody your revenues, your costs, where they come from, even on a team level, so the teams can feel as if they're running their own business and also influence the costs and the revenues at the same time. Once again, the example of Hire is a great example, where they created this network of 4,000 micro enterprises, and each of the micro enterprises acts as a separate business. So they have full transparency on salaries, micro enterprise financials, their revenues, their costs. They also share the profits, so they can very easily see, if I save a bit of cost here, this benefits myself plus my teammates. If we make more revenue and grow our company, this also benefits us directly. So it's interesting, and they create lots of transparency around all of the information that teams need in order to excel in their work. Then the final trend is from job descriptions to talents and mastery. So how can you get away from the idea that people are hired for one specific job description that neatly states everyone's day-to-day activities? And instead, how can you focus on finding those talents and those things that people like to do most in their work, and then craft a specific and customized job around that person's talents, so they can actually get to do the thing they like to do most? And looking at these eight trends, we did a big research study here in the Netherlands to figure out whether these eight trends were actually present in today's organizations or not. And painfully, we found that this final trend, the talents and mastery trend, was the one that was most lacking here. 33% of the people said they could use their main talent in their day-to-day work, meaning that 67% of the people felt they couldn't. So they have all these talents and things that they like to do at work, but they don't get the chance to actually do it, meaning that we're using or missing out on a lot of potential and talent to both motivate people and to get them to be successful in what it is that they try to do. So as you can imagine, quite painful, and a lot needs to change for companies to push more towards the right-hand side. And that doesn't mean that all these progressive organizations show these trends very clearly. Some pick and choose the ones that best fit their work environment, because, and hopefully you all know this, there's no one-size-fits-all solution to creating a happy, highly engaged workplace. But there are common denominators that these companies focus on strongly to give their people the mastery, the autonomy, and the purpose that is so important to be truly motivated at work. So besides the more abstract level of showing the trends, I'm now going to go into an example that very clearly shows almost eight trends very radically. And you've probably not even heard about this organization. The organization is called Buurtzorg, which is Dutch for neighborhood care. And the man you see here is Jos de Blok, who's been founding the company since 15 years ago and has been now the CEO for quite some time. But back in the days in 2005, when he started this organization, he came from a background of home care nursing. So he was a nurse himself, became very frustrated in a traditional nursing organization, and then felt the need to start an organization himself that was not focused on efficiencies and optimizing, but instead focused on the autonomy of nurses. Because he experienced himself that all this command and control and all this bureaucracy was actually getting in the way of delivering good healthcare. So as a home care nurse himself, he thought we have to organize ourselves around those talents and around the skills of the people that we've hired. And then all we need to do as an organization is to get out of the way and let those people do the thing they like to do most. So we started with a team of four nurses here in the Netherlands. And when the team started to grow, when it grew over 12 people, the team split into two teams. And then once those teams reached again the magic number of 12, they split again. So exponentially, these teams and the organization started to grow, creating new teams every time the existing teams reached more than 12 people. The organization has grown exponentially over the past 15 years and now employs 15,000 people, still being organized in this very flat organizational way. So no hierarchy. There's just two people who are directing the organization. Other than that, there's more than 1,000 self-managing teams who decide almost everything themselves. So those teams of 10 to 12 nurses focus on one specific neighborhood, take care of all of the people that need to be taken care of in that area, and also take care of, for example, onboarding new employees, hiring them, firing them if needed, planning the work, executing the work, making sure they have the supplies in place. So all of that work is being done by the Buurtzorg teams themselves. There are no separate support departments who take care of all of that work for them and then tell them how they should be doing their job. So it's a quite different approach to work. And let's briefly look at it in a bit more detail. So as I mentioned, 15,000 employees, more than 1,000 self-managed teams. So within those teams, there's not a manager, meaning there's not a single manager in the entire organization. So 15,000 people, not a single manager in the entire organization. There's just a team of about 25 coaches who support the teams if they run into problems they cannot solve themselves. But for these coaches, they do not have any decision-making power over the team. So they're truly just there to support and they can't dictate the teams how they should be doing their work. Then there's two directors. So Jos de Blok and one other director who are leading your organization on a more strategic level and mainly guiding the operating model of the organization to make sure that it stays focused on the autonomy of nurses. There's just 50 people support staff in the headquarters. So once again, 15,000 people in this entire organization, zero managers, and just 50 people support staff. And they take care of the administrative stuff, for example, dealing with insurance companies to get the money, setting up contracts, all the stuff that they don't want to bother the teams with. But truly there just to support, and not as in many traditional organizations where the support departments like HR or finance actually dictate how operational teams should be doing their work. So it's quite a different approach. As you can imagine, overhead costs are quite a bit lower. So at Buurtzorg, overhead costs are 67% lower than what their traditional counterparts are seeing. So they're way cheaper in delivering this kind of healthcare to its patients. Plus, they have the highest employee and client satisfaction of any home care nursing organization in the Netherlands. And as you can imagine, extremely low levels of staff turnover. And maybe even more interestingly, they cure patients faster than the competition, meaning that they engage their people to a higher extent. And in turn, those people get to cure the patients faster than their traditional counterparts. So therefore, significantly outperforming traditional home care nursing organizations. So quite a bit different, as you can imagine. And this organization has shown that by reducing the hierarchy, by giving people autonomy, by giving people freedom and responsibility, you actually get to do a better job as an organization in delivering the products and services that you want to deliver. And as I mentioned, there have been 150 of these organizations on our list that have done similar things in their organization. So one quick reminder, if you have any questions on this, on Buurtzorg or any of the trends that I just talked about, put them in the Q&A section so we can dive into them. I'm going to skip this example because it's due to a time constraint, and I'd like to actually have some more time to dive into the Q&A section. But before doing that, I want to share you a bit more on what can you do to create such a workplace revolution inside your organization. Because many people look at these companies and then go, well, it's great that it works over there, but it will never work in our organization. And then they come up with loads of different reasons. Our company is too small, it's too big, it's in the wrong region in the world, it doesn't fit our culture, we're in the wrong industry, it will never work in our specific kind of sector. And all these excuses pop up. But I want to show you that by with these more than 150 organizations we've seen in different sectors, different regions of the world, different sizes, it can happen in any type of organization. Leveraging the human potential in these organizations is vitally important to becoming more successful, but especially in creating more engaging workplaces. Before I wrap up, I want to share an example of a company that has transformed very much from the bottom up. So it didn't need the approval of the CEO to make a transformation focused on these 8 trends that I've been talking about. And it's a very interesting organization. It's a Dutch e-commerce company called bol.com. So it's more or less the Dutch version of Amazon. And because bol.com has been doing such a good job, we don't really have Amazon being very present here in the Netherlands. And Harm Jans, the guy who you see here, has been working in that organization for quite some time. And he himself was leading some time ago a team of 20 people in the logistics department. So just a small part of the organization, but he was inspired by many of the companies that we've been visiting over the years. And when he read about them, he wanted to be inspired by what they were doing. And he also wanted to implement some of the ideas in his organization. So together with his 20 people logistics team, he created a pitch deck and went up to the CEO to pitch their ideas of this radical organizational transformation. And when he then came to the CEO, he pitched the ideas. CEO was very happy with the fact that there was so much initiative coming from the team. But he said, we're not going to do it. I don't believe that such a radical transformation will benefit us as an organization. So I don't want to go down this radical transformation path of changing the way we work. So Harm, as you can imagine, was quite disappointed, went back to his logistics team and said, well, there's 2 things we can do now. We can either listen to the CEO and continue working as we've always done, or we can try to experiment with new ways of working in our own team. So we can try to influence the things that we have inside our control. For example, the way we run meetings, the way we make decisions, the way we distribute roles and responsibilities within the team. So lots of things that they could do themselves as a team to create a better workplace for themselves. So they started experimenting, and every month they set up a new experiment to improve their way of working based on the feedback they got from the team. They were constantly tracking the engagement and the productivity of the team to figure out whether they were actually becoming more successful in how they worked. And over time, they had been able to change quite a lot of things that were inside their control. And then they said, well, if we want to push this further, if we want more people to adopt these new ways of working in our company, we need to start other people to know about what we're doing. So they started to share their ideas on the intranet of the company, started to write blog posts, making videos, went up on company stages when there were general meetings where they could share what they had been up to, and also the benefit it had to both the employees and the success of the team. So they started to make these changes, then communicate about it, and then other teams picked up the phone to ask Harm and his team if they could support them to change in a similar fashion. So they wanted to do the same thing that Harm was doing, and therefore called him to ask him for advice and for support to also transform their way of working. So the team from Harm then became coaches to others in the organization to start doing the same thing. And over a time period of about 3 years, they had been able to transform more than 70% of the entire organization, simply by what they started doing in that small 20-person logistics team. They had been able to build an internal change movement, get other teams on board, and support them to change their way of working too. Now, Harm has been promoted to become the director of people operations in the organization. So now he's able to make bigger changes, for example, changing the organizational structure to become even more progressive as an organization. So he's now changing the things that were way beyond his control a couple of years ago. So interestingly, this bottom-up movement within Bol.com has changed for a big part how this company works. So joining the revolution, if any of you is interested to start applying some of these ideas and new ways of working in their company, the good news is that you don't need to wait for the CEO to start a transformation like this. Instead, it's about first finding your allies. Find the people in the organization that are interested in doing the same thing as you would like to do. So try to get them interested in these new ways of working. Then, once you have those, set up small yet radical experiments to change. Make them small so they don't endanger the organization and are not being killed if one thing goes wrong, but make them radical at the same time to make sure that you can actually try something radically new and not just this incremental change that nobody will ever notice. So try to be radical, but keep it small to contain the risk. And then once you've figured out what is successful and what helps you to create a better, more engaging way of working, start to build an internal change movement and start supporting others in the organization to jump on board and to become pioneers as well. And then if you're as successful as Harmjans, you can change the entire way of working of the entire company. So it doesn't need to come from the top. Of course, support is very much appreciated if you have it from the top, but if you don't have it, you can still start changing the things that have a big impact on how you work. Changing the meeting structures, changing decision-making, creating more transparency, redistributing roles and responsibilities. So there's quite a few things that you can do to make your own work together with your teammates more fun to start with. For more ideas on what I've just talked about just in 30 minutes, go to the Corporate Rebels shop and be one of the first to actually get their hands on the Turkish translation of the book. I have no clue how to pronounce this and I'm not going to try it either. But it's the, as I mentioned, a sort of summary of all of the pioneering organizations that we've seen over the past couple of years. And I'm pretty sure some inspiring examples of companies similar to Boots or similar to Bol.com who have created radically new and progressive ways of working. So my main invitation to you guys is to become a rebel inside your organization too. If we want to get rid of those painful numbers that I showed at the beginning of the presentation, we all need to come in action to start changing our way of working. Because otherwise people will continue to be disengaged, unhappy, sometimes even sick or feeling useless in the workplace. And we need to stop it. So we invite you to become a rebel too inside your organization to start experimenting with new ways of working so we can actually create organizations that are much more fun and much more productive to work in. Thanks a lot for your attention.
Thank you, Pim. Thank you for your inspirational stories and your great talk. So we would like to ask you some questions from our audience. So the first one is about how can we transform those large organizations into such pioneering companies you speak of? And what should be the first step to transform those companies?
Well, I think, as I just mentioned, like I think the main step is about creating more consciousness around new ways of working, showing how painful today's way of working mostly is to many companies, showing how positive it can be to transform a company into this less hierarchical, more autonomous way of working can be very beneficial. I think starting with that consciousness level and then start getting into action. Like, don't wait too long. Don't craft too many detailed plans. Just start experimenting in your team. You're going to make a lot of mistakes along the way. That's perfectly fine. But at least get started, get things, get to try new things, because only then you will figure out what will actually work for you as an organization and what will not work.
Thank you. Next question is about, actually, it's about Agile, by the way. You didn't mention any Agile way of working, any frameworks in your presentation. So our audience is curious about, is there a connection between this Agile stuff with the things that you mentioned in your talk?
Yeah, so as you could have seen, there's quite a lot of overlap between those things. And we're just very careful not to dive into buzzwords or general names for things. And yes, as I mentioned also, there's quite a lot of things, if you look at that, more experimenting and adapting and getting away from the idea of making long-term plans and using the waterfall methods and all these kinds of things. I think agile organizations could be one like name for these pioneering organizations, but I think it's much broader as well than that. It's much goes much further than just implementing agile ways of working in an organization. It's really throwing the entire organizational structure upside down, creating more meaning in the workplace, and getting people to really be as autonomous as possible in the work that they're doing. So yes, certainly a big overlap. I think there's, however, a very big change of a very big difference between these pioneering organizations and many large corporate organizations that are implementing Agile. I think this goes way beyond what we see in most traditional organizations. It goes way beyond what we see in many, many corporate organizations. And yes, they get inspired sometimes by the same companies, but the way they approach it can be quite different.
Thank you. The next question is about leaders. Do you have any tactics? How can we convince executive leaders in our companies, in such companies, to transform, to be more rebellious ones?
Well, I think, as I mentioned, like, it's important to start with showing that today's way of working isn't really working, that there are alternatives. But as you've also seen in Harm's example, the Bol.com example, that doesn't always need to convince senior executives to transform in such radical ways. So I think the most important thing is to start doing it. There's so many things you can do on a team level or in a departmental level to show that a new way of working is super beneficial. And I think in the end, if you have the evidence to show for that people are more engaged and that organization becomes more successful with a new way of working, then it will be quite easy to convince also senior people in the organization to start doing things differently. So, and I think that's also where the rebel part comes in, like try doing things that are maybe not the norm or not expected of you in the organization. But if you do them with a very good idea of how you'd like to improve the organization and you can actually show the results, I think that's the best starting point for any transformation.
Thank you. Our last question is about the future, by the way. Do you think that rebellious corporations will dominate the future? How many years do you think that will come?
I've learned that the easiest way to make a fool out of yourself is to try and predict the future. So I'm not going to burn my fingers on that one, but I think it will take quite some time. Like, people are so used to traditional ways of working. We've been educated in traditional systems. We have worked in traditional systems for all our lives. And there's just a few companies around the world who teach us that things can be done differently. So I think it will take some time. We need to do more talking about this. I think the Agile movement has really advanced new ways of working, but there's still so much work to be done. I think I have no clue how long it will take, but I think it will take longer than we'd like it to take. That's why we all actually need to fight for it and start experimenting, start trying new things, and focusing on how we can actually create workplaces where people love to be, because that is, for most corporates, very far from their current realities.
Thank you. Thank you for the answer. And also, as I mentioned, for your great talk. We are very happy to host you, and I hope to see you in future Agile Turkey summits in Istanbul and in person. So thank you very much for your time and your talk.
Thanks a lot. And Istanbul sounds a lot better than from this video screen. Yeah.